I don't know if you enjoy the Peanuts cartoons, but I remember one which Snoopy is walking by on a wintry day and he's shivering and you can tell he's cold and hungry. And Charlie Brown sees him and says, "Snoopy, be warm and well-fed." But he doesn't do anything, and Snoopy looks at him with this question mark. Well, in 1 John, he deals with this issue and says, what good is it to say you have compassion for somebody, but you don't do anything for them? Well, we've just had storms come through our area, and a lot of people have been impacted. Property has been destroyed, and very sadly, there's been loss of life. We are so grateful that more lives were not lost, but our hearts ache for those who are grieving. So our church wants to do something in terms of response. And we're going to take a special offering this Sunday. I'm asking you, don't just pull out a couple of bucks. Let's give a generous gift as a church to help care for the people who are in need. We're going to help out through a special fund that is set up in Cook County that will be administrated by the leaders of Cook County. We're going to work through Adel United Methodist Church. But I don't want us to forget, in our own congregation, there are two people that we're aware of who suffered some loss of property, one of whom lost half their house. And we want to help them specifically. So we're asking you to bring a generous, sacrificial, loving gift. And let's just not speak compassion. Let's show compassion this Sunday.
During the hymn. And then I'll tell them.
Amen.
good morning. It's good to see you all. We're so glad you're here in worship with us today. It's good to be able to come to church and not worry about trees and such falling on you on your way here. So I wanted to offer a few things for you this morning as I say good morning to you and glad that you're here. And obviously we've had some damage done in our community and Adel and other areas last week with the storms. And in talking with churches up there and organizations up there, the one thing they said is, we've got plenty of stuff. I mean, the community, especially in Cook County, showed up and just, they have all the physical items they need. In talking with the pastor at Adel United Methodist Church, one thing they decided that they wanted to do to help their community was to come alongside of some families there that are not going to be able to, otherwise they wouldn't be able to pay for the funeral expenses for their loved ones that have passed because of the storms. And so this morning, separate from our regular offering, actually as we sing the next hymn that's coming up in a moment, there is an offering plate here at the altar rail. And if you would like to make a special offering today to help those families. We also have actually a few people within our church that were affected. Thankfully, they were okay physically, but their homes took on some damage. And we want to help come alongside of those folks. And we're going to help with Adel United Methodist Church, and also a count has been set up in Cook County, and the area pastors and some community leaders are going to be overseeing that. So whatever offering we have today, we already did it at 8:45. We're taking one up in the Solomon's Porch services as well. You can make the check if you want to write a check to First United Methodist Church, Valdosta, and then we'll send one later this week. So we hope that you might want to be a part of that. In a moment, I'm going to say a prayer, and then as we start to sing the hymn, children may go with Miss Amy to the children's church, and then if you have an offering, you can bring it here. And if you are unable to get up here or worried about that, you can raise your hand, and I'm sure an usher will help you out. Or maybe someone nearby would be happy to bring it up here for you. But let's pray together. God, thank you that we get to come together and be in your presence this morning. We get to pause in the middle of the busyness of life and come together as the body of Christ and to praise you, to lift our voices in praise, in song, in prayer, in looking at your word, to be encouraged together today. Father, we do remember the families, the many, many families who have been affected by the storms recently, and ask God that they sense a special presence of your Holy Spirit this very day. God, thank you that we can participate. We can be present in their lives. We can be the hands and the feet and the heart of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together hymn number, 555, Forward Through the Ages. Children, you're dismissed to go with Miss Amy, and the offering plate is here if you'd like to bring an offering.
Forward through the ages in a broken heart. I'd like to invite you to sing with uplifted voices, Marching to Zion.
Oh,
Well, thank you, Chancel Choir, for, you know, because I'm over in Solomon's Porch so much, I don't get to hear a choir sing. I mean, there's some great vocalists over there, but wow, when a collective group of people lift their voices in praise, I mean, it's just, I mean, it makes you think about standing before God and worshiping Him forever and ever and ever. So thank you all for your ministry to our church and the blessing that you all are every single week. So thank you so much. Would you all thank our choir for being such faithful people? They don't do it for the applause, they do it for the big paycheck. So so you may be wondering why the change of furnishings this morning. I'm a visual learner. It's the way I take in and process information. When I see something, it kind of, I get it. It helps me to learn that way. And so as I was preparing this message, and we were actually talking about this whole series, Bob and I, a month or so ago, this image came in my mind. It's probably something I read at some point a long time ago, so I'm sure it's not an original thought. But as Solomon said, there's nothing new under the sun, so it's always good to know. But so I'm thinking about this, and we're talking about relationships. We're finishing up our series on a relationship goals. And in week one, Bob shared with you this necessity for us to be in relationship with God. It really, you've got to get that one kind of squared away before you can even start to talk about the other relationships. Makes sense. And in the second week, we talked about the parent-child relationship, and that's whether you're a parent with littles now or maybe you're an adult with older parents, but that relationship is ongoing through the years. And last week, the plan was to talk about the marriage relationship, that sweetheart kind of relationship, but of course, the weather had other plans for us. Today, what I want to talk about is really about the others, but I'm going to lump in all the stuff I just mentioned. I'm going to lump in spouse and children, but there's also some others. When you think about relationships, see, there's people that you choose to spend your time with. There's people that you choose to do life with. You know, you said I do to someone maybe, or you have children or grandchildren. You have extended family. You have friends that are almost become like family for you. You've got people that you want to spend time with, but then there's people that you work with. There's people that you rub elbows with in various ways, from the grocery store, the bank, to clubs and organizations you're in. But we are in relationship with a lot of different people. So why the furniture? Well, here's the thought, that the image that I had. And I pray, and I've been praying this, and that this would be an image that will stay with you for a really long time. The chair before you this morning is designed for one person. It's not designed for a lot of people. You can try to fit people in there. Talking about sweethearts, you know, there's a time when maybe you did want to try and fit two of you in the chair, but the chair is designed for one. And this chair, folks, represents our relationship with God. Not someone else's relationship, not your spouse's, not your granny who's like the most saintly woman you've ever known. It's not. This chair represents your relationship with God. And the couch represents every other relationship you'll ever have, every human relationship you have, but the chair represents your relationship with God. And when you think about it, this chair, everything you do in this chair is going to affect every relationship that you have on the couch. And everything you don't do in the chair is going to affect every relationship on the couch. See, in the chair, what happens is, and it could be a physical chair. I'll ask you this question this morning. Do you have a chair? I mean, I know you got chairs in your house, but do you have a chair that you have dedicated to spending time with God? And maybe it's not always the same chair. Maybe you move around. Maybe it's in different places. But is there a place, is there a time, is there a moment in your day-to-day life where you choose to spend time with God? See, because even what we're doing right now in church, all of us together, we're just on a big old couch. See, we're together. We're talking about God, which is amazing, and it's wonderful, and it's what we're called to do, to be together and worship, but we're on the couch right now. And if this is the only time that you're having a thought about God, or the only time you're praying is when someone else is leading you in prayer, you're missing out on the chair. See, we all need the chair. We need to be spending time in the chair. Because in the chair, what happens is that God gives us identity, and he gives us value. In the chair, God says to us that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. He says, I have created you in my image. So this is the things that God tells us. God tells us in the chair, you are my co-heirs of the kingdom. He tells us these things. He tells us, oh my goodness, he teaches us about love. He teaches us about forgiveness. Right? You sit in this chair and you start saying, oh God, I really messed that one up. Oh, I blew that. Oh, I'm so sorry. And we learn about forgiveness. We learn about grace. We learn about mercy. We learn about all these things in the chair. When you spend time with God in the chair. The problem with the couch, I mean, there's good things about the couch. We're designed to be in relationship with other people, don't get me wrong. But apart from the chair, we're going to mess things up. See, you can sit in this couch alongside of someone who is really amazing. Someone that you would look up to. You know, you would say, I want to be like them one day. I want to love God like they do. I want to worship like they do. I want to give like they do. But eventually that person who is imperfect, you know, they're fallible and they're mortal. They're not going to be here forever. This person that you might think is amazing, at some point in some way, shape, or fashion, they might let you down. They might not mean to, might not be intentional, but they might. And if we don't know about our relationship with God, if we don't have this thing, if we don't know who we are and who God wants us to be in the chair, then we get on the couch and things get confused, things get mixed up. Talking about our identity and value, you know, I don't know about you. I don't know how you grew up, and adolescence is just it's a crazy time. But you know, there's a lot of people who sat on a couch, and they had someone else tell them who they are. You'll never amount to anything. You're no good. You're dumb. You're just like your dad. You know, people. Things have been spoken to people on the couch. And they developed their identity. They developed their value sitting on this couch. Someone else told them. And maybe some of it was good. You know, like right now, Mallory thinks she is the fastest girl in the world because I've told her this over and over again. This is going to come crashing down at some point. She's going to find out that Mom obviously doesn't know very many fast people. You know, so you might have been told wonderful things, but folks, our true identity and our true value is found in the chair. And in order for us to be people who can live I prayed about being the hands and feet of Christ, right? We talk about that. That's a term we say a lot in the church. And it's a beautiful image, and there's truth in that. But if we really want to be the hands and feet of Christ, we got to spend time in the chair. We got to know who is this God we worship? Who is this Jesus that brings about redemption and life? Who is this Holy Spirit that guides us and directs us and makes his word come alive? We have to spend time in the chair. Do you have a chair? Do you have a chair? Because folks, we need to be in the chair. Because it's in this that we're equipped to really be in relationship with others. Some of whom we love. Some of whom we've chosen to love. Some who maybe we don't get along with that much at all. Some people maybe we don't agree on anything, but here we do. We find ourselves together in class, at work. We've got to be in the chair. I want us to look at two passages of Scripture this morning, and they both give this image. It helps to magnify this image of the chair and the couch. First one is in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. And I think in this, Ephesians 1, 5, and 2, you see kind of the characteristics of spending time in the chair, of what it looks like. And I'll start here in Ephesians 5, beginning in verse 1, it says this, imitate God, and there's a comma, which is a good place for the comma because I want to stop there for a second. Imitate God. Paul is writing this letter to the church in Ephesus, and what he did, and you see it a lot in the epistles, he's writing letters to a church, a new church, a church of new believers, of people who are walking in their faith, and he's writing them a series of letters and saying, look, guys, you got to do this better. Man, you're really messing that up, or keep doing this. It's encouragement. It's guidance, and he's writing to the church, and he's telling these people who are all on this couch together, right? And the first two words is imitate God. See, the only way that they could be the church of Jesus in Ephesus was first to imitate God. And folks, that's the chair. You know, that would be like, me saying, hey, Ryan, could you do an imitation of Max Clark, my dad? Could you do that real quick? There's a little problem, see. Ryan's never met Max Clark. And if he had, he would certainly be able to do an imitation of him because he's a character. You can't imitate God unless you spend time with him. Paul's telling the church, imitate God. How in the world can we imitate someone we haven't spent any time with? We need to get in the chair. Get in the chair. Imitate God, it says. Therefore, in everything you do, therefore, because you've imitated God, in everything you do, because you are as dear children, see, that's identity and value, folks. How do you know you are the dear children of God? I mean, sure, someone can tell you that. But I don't know about you folks, but, you know, I've read that before and I've had someone speak that to me and I'm like, yeah. But then there's been times I've been sitting in my chair, I've been in my place, I've been praying and seeking God, and I felt His Holy Spirit say to me, Shannon, you are my dear child. See, that's a chair thing. So he says, imitate God, chair, because you are His dear children, and then here it is, live a life filled with love. See, that's couch relationships. Following the example of Christ. Oh, what is that? Oh, we spend time in the chair. That's how we find this out. See, the characteristics of someone who has spent time in the chair is they live a life filled with love. They know who they are. They are the dear children of God. They are doing their best to imitate Him, living a life filled with love. So you see the chair and the couch. He loved us. I like this. He loved us and He offered Himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Oh, wow. If we're going to live out our relationship with God, if we're going to live out a pleasing aroma to Him, well, that starts in the chair. That'd be like me saying, honey, I fixed your favorite, you know, fish stew, you know, and when he comes home from work and he's like, I don't like fish stew. I think it's disgusting. Well, see, if I know my husband better, he's not going to find that a pleasing aroma when he walks in the house. So what's a pleasing aroma to God? We find out in the chair. We find out in the chair. And here's the deal. And I know it sounds like one of these blanket promises. See, we spend time on this couch with other people. And I know for me, sometimes I spend more time trying to help. I'm trying to control the other person, to fix the outcome of the other person. When really, the more time I spend in that chair, when I get on this couch, I can be someone who's imitating God. I can be a wonderful aroma. I can be someone who is living a life filled with love, even if the other person isn't. And so if I'm spending time in the chair, picture yourself, you've spent time in the chair, and now you've come and you sat on the couch because you're a human being and you're made to be in relationship with others. So here you are with others. Even if the other person is not living up to their end of the deal, you're going to find, if I spend time in the chair, I'm going to be a better spouse to Drew. I'm going to be a better mom to Mallory. I'm going to be a better friend because I've spent time in the chair. See, because I want to imitate God. I want to live a life filled with love. I'm going to be not only a better parent and spouse and friend, but I'm going to be a better sibling. I'm gonna be better with my dad. I'm gonna be better with the people I work alongside with. See, that's good news. Kenji and Linda and Cindy. Wake up, Cindy. I'm gonna be a better coworker with you if I spend time in the chair. So every relationship that we have on the couch, every relationship is affected by the time that I spend in the chair. Every relationship that you're in is affected by the time you spend in this chair. It's also affected by the time you don't spend in the chair. So we need to be in the chair. I think, I need some, like, couple of things to think about this couch. And here's one, the couple that popped in my mind. Understanding that it all starts with the chair. What does God want us to see from us on the couch? What does he want us to focus on and see? And one of them is this, and it's probably because I was single for 38 years of my life, I can say this with confidence. When you spend time on the couch, you need to make sure that you're focusing on you becoming the right person. Like I mentioned a minute ago, sometimes we sit on the couch and we're like, well, if that old bozo would, you know, if they would just, you know, we think a lot about the other people. If they would just start doing this, or if they would just stop doing that, you know, and we're just sitting on the couch. No, I need to spend time in the chair so that when I'm on the couch, regardless of what the other person is doing, I'm a person that's living in right relationship with God. And therefore, I'm going to be living in right relationship with others. See, too often we focus on the other person. Listen, married people do this too. Not just, you know, with single people, you think, oh, I'm just waiting for the right person to come along. You know, I'm just going to sit here. Get in the chair. Get in the chair. Be that person. Be that right person. Married people, maybe we need to quit expecting our spouse to be the one to change and to do something different or to stop doing something. And we spend time in the chair so that when we're on the couch, we're honoring God with our lives. How many people are in broken relationships with others? Maybe family members, maybe their own kids or friends or coworkers, someone they know well, and they're expecting the other person to make things right. Oh, if we would just spend time in the chair. Doesn't mean it's going to fix everything. No promise of rainbows and butterflies and sunshine. But if we spend time in the chair, we've been in His presence, we know who we are. I'm not letting someone else tell me who I am. No one else is going to tell me what my value is. No one else is going to tell me my identity because I've spent time in the chair. And so, yeah, maybe what you say to me and what happens, it might hurt. It might hurt for a while. But I still got my chair. I'm spending time with God. So we need this. We need both of these pieces of furniture are so important. But too many of us, we've just got a couch. And then we wonder why our relationships of all different kinds are messed up. Because we need to spend time in the chair. Here's another thing we need to do besides just knowing that we need to become the right person is we need to be someone who is walking in love in all these relationships. We're someone saying, you know what, you might not be walking in love. We're sitting on the couch together and you might not be walking in love, but I'm going to walk in love because I have spent time here. Mark chapter 12, verse 30 through 31. It is a very, very well-known passage of Scripture. You know it. You've heard it many times. Oh, my goodness. Listen to this. There is this, this to me, as I was reading this about a month ago, I was like, this is the chair. This is the couch. Someone came up to Jesus, and they said, you know, Master, what is the greatest commandment? What is the most important commandment? And He said this, love the Lord your God. Chair. With all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, with all your soul. That's a chair relationship. You don't do that apart. This is when you are spending time with God, you are in His presence, you are allowing Him to be Lord. Oh God, you're God. See, how many times do we get on the couch and we forget about the chair and suddenly we decide we're going to be Lord? Or worse, we might make someone else a Lord. We might make someone else a God. And what they say and what they do becomes all important to us. Now, we spend time in the chair and we love God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, with all our strength. That's the chair. And then Jesus said, but the second is just as important. Love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. Love them. See, that's the chair and the couch. Love the Lord your God with all that you've got, and then love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. So we need to walk in love in all these relationships. The third thing is this. I think I've alluded to this already, but is we need to make sure, I talked about making someone else Lord, making someone else God, is that we are not fixing our hopes on people. When I was a new believer, I can't remember who, but somebody thought that my brain could handle C.S. Lewis' Mere Christianity. If you've ever read it, you know what I'm talking about. It's a thin book, but it's the kind of book you read one sentence, and then you go, and then you read that sentence again, you go, And you know, it's one of those. It takes a long time to read. I'm highlighting it. I'm dog-earing it. And there was this quote that he made in the book, and I'm going to paraphrase. And I have used this quote so many times, talking to so many people in so many areas and stages of their life. single people, married people. People are thinking maybe we don't want to be married anymore. People who are grieving, people who are excited about what's coming. I mean, I've shared this because it's just so profound to me. Because here's why it was profound. Prior to coming to know Christ, prior to giving myself to him, one, Drew would have had wanted nothing to do with me before I'd spent a little bit of time in the chair. He just wouldn't have. He might have been kind to me, but he wouldn't have. There's no way that guy would have married me. I was becoming new. I was being made new. We never graduate from this chair, by the way. Wherever you are in your faith journey, you never graduate from this. We all need it all the time, forever, till he calls us home. But so as a new believer, I was like, not knowing God, all I knew was other relationships with other people. And I had let a lot of different relationships and connections be, you know, like a crashing wave. You know, when things were great, they were great. And when they weren't, they were horrible. And I let my life be affected by this in such, I mean, a dark way, an unhealthy way. And I read this quote from C.S. Lewis. He said this, "Don't put all your hope in people, because the best of them will fail you, and all of them will die." Ugh. Sobering, but true. Don't fix all your hopes on people, because the best of the best are going to let you down. The best of the best, whether mean to or not, are going to let you down. Folks, we need the chair so that when the best of the best let us down, our world is not over. We're not debilitated. We're not unable to function, because we have the chair. We have this chair. We shouldn't be fixing our hopes of people. We should be someone who spends time in the chair, knows our identity, knows our value. We are living a life filled with love so that we're on the couch when someone isn't perfect. Imagine that. We're able to minister to them, and our lives aren't thrown into turmoil because of it, if things aren't great with them, between us possibly, because we've spent time in the chair. We've spent time in the chair. And I know I keep saying it over and over. Some of you are going, okay, I've got it. I've got the chair. But do we really have the chair? I mean, I know you're hearing me say it over and over again, but do you get it? Do I get this? That we need to be people who spend time in the chair. Because every relationship we will ever have will be affected by the time spent here. Or the time not spent here. We need to be people who get in the chair. Last thought I want to give you. People who let their relationships revolve around, start here on the couch and revolve here around the couch and end on the couch, it might be good for a while. You might be pleasant. But eventually somebody's going to fail somebody, hurt somebody, disappoint somebody. And is that it? Is that all we've got? But see, relationships that start here in the chair and then revolve around, you know, always connected to the chair, and they end here with the chair. See, those are relationships that God will pour into. Doesn't mean they're perfect. But if we're here in the chair, then like I said, marriages, parenting, older parents, grown children, the prodigals, the hurt people, everything, the good, all of it are going to be affected by this time we spend in the chair, in the chair. So I just want to offer that to you this morning, this image. It's been my prayer. It'll continue to be my prayer that you don't forget it. Get in the chair. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for what you have taught me, most definitely for what you've shown me, what you've been speaking to me about this, Lord. I pray, God, this morning that as your people, we would see, we would take this and we would apply it, that even as we were listening this morning, that application was going on. God, I pray for those who have had their identity and their values shaped on the couch instead of by you in the chair. I pray, God, that you would start to speak love and truth into their lives. That their ears would be open to hear you. God, I pray for the relationships that are hurting on the couch. that are broken, that are in turmoil, that maybe it's the world's largest couch because one is sitting on one end and the other is way on the other side. God, I pray that those relationships, God, that the individuals in here this morning would say, I'm going to spend time in the chair and I'm going to see what God wants me to do, how He wants me to live out a life of love with this other person. God, what do you want me to do? I know who I am in you, and now I want to live that life out with others. God, thank you that we do get to come and be together and worship together and be on this couch together, the church. Help us to encourage one another and to continue to grow in love. All of this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing our closing hymn together. Hymn number 557, Blessed Be the Ties That Bind. God, will you receive this benediction? Go and get in the chair and live out the results of that time in the chair in the world, filled with love. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen.
Hi, I'm Bob Moon, the senior pastor here at First Methodist Church in Valdosta. And I want to talk with you about something that maybe you've never heard of. It was a new word to me, even though the idea was not necessarily new. But it put it in a helpful way. I want to talk with you for a few minutes today about the second half of the gospel. The second half of the gospel. Now, you may be saying, what? I didn't know that there was a first half and a second half to the gospel. Well, let me take you to a study done by George Barna. His research institute did a lot of work interviewing a lot of people here in America to try to understand what they understood about their faith. And here's what he came up with. We don't just come to faith in Christ, like that's step one and it's all over. Matter of fact, sometimes we've done pretty badly, I hate to admit this, in the church, and some of us have done this pretty badly, I hate to admit this, as pastors, in explaining what the gospel really calls us to. Sometimes we think, well, it's all just about receive Jesus, and you get a get out of hell card, and that's it. I'm going to heaven, and that's all there is. You know, that's a part of the truth, but that's by no means the whole of it. So, what do we mean about the first part of the gospel and the second part of the gospel? Well, let's just talk about it. In his research, Barna came up with 10 stages or 10 steps along the journey of faith. And to just give you a foresight of where I'm going, he says right up through number 5 is where 89% of people are. And only 11% go on to what he calls the second half of the gospel. So let's just dive right on in and go there. What's the first half of the gospel? Well, he says along this journey of faith, there are people who are a one with just no awareness of sin at all. And then as they move along, they say, well, yeah, you know, there is such a thing as sin, but, you know, I'm not really sure what to do with it. And then the third step would be, well, they're concerned about, well, what is sin doing in my life? And then step 4 is they say, I need help about this, and they turn to Jesus. And then step 5, they go and they say, so what am I supposed to do? Well, this is the point at which we rightly say, you ought to be baptized, and you ought to become a part of the church, the family of God. All of this is right, and it's the first half of the gospel. Unfortunately, some of us just stop right there. And we never go on from there. It's as though all that we have to deal with is, well, I was a sinner, and I come to Jesus, and at the cross, Jesus died for my sin, and it's finished. Well, you know, that's true, but that's not all of the gospel. Go back to the beginning of Genesis. Consider this. Does the story begin with sin? The answer is no, it really doesn't. Sin shows up in Genesis chapter 3 with Adam and Eve in the garden. Where does the story start? It starts in Genesis 1 and 2. What's that about? It's about a relationship with God. Adam and Eve are created, and God says, that's very good. And every day he goes and takes a walk with them in the garden. There is a perfect relationship. Well, then sin enters in, and yes, Jesus finally comes to make the way for us to get back into the right relationship with God. But it's more than just about wiping away our sins. It's about restoring the relationship. That's the second half of the gospel. That's where we start moving into a deeper walk with God. And here's where it begins in the sixth step. He talks about a holy dissatisfaction. I like that term. It's like, well, yes, Jesus has saved me. But there's got to be more to it than this. It's not just a get-out-of-hell card. And it isn't. There is a relationship that God wants to draw us into. But then here comes the next step. It's a holy brokenness where we recognize our need before God in a whole new dimension. We say, God, I thank you that you've saved me, but I still have so much of my old self here. Somebody said, well, God took the people out of Egypt, but then he needed to get Egypt out of the people. It's when we realize there's sin in me that God still wants to root out and get me into that right relationship with God. Well, when we get into that place of brokenness, some of us just retreat back and say, I don't want to go there. But here is what happens. When we step into that brokenness and we allow God to break our hearts and to draw us into that intimate relationship with him, what happens is there is a new place of surrender, a new place that says, God, I long for you. I want to submit to you. I don't just want to be saved from hell. I want to have my life transformed, and I want to walk with you. That leads us, number 9, into a place where there is a profound connection, love connection with God. And that leads to number 10, where there is an extreme love for people. And here's what Barna says. 89% of us stop on that side. Only 11% of us go on beyond that. Well, brothers and sisters, here's what I want to say to you. And I say it to myself too. Will you receive this challenge today? To go into that second half of the gospel. We're not just to stop partway on the journey. God wants to draw us into a full, vital, deep, loving, passionate relationship with himself. This is where our call is, and this is where God's invitation is. When the prodigal son was away and got into the pig pen, he said, oh, I need to go back home. That's good. But what if he just stopped partway home? He needed to get all the way home and find the mercy of his Father who loved him and drew him back. And today, I want to just encourage you. Would you let God stir holy discontent in you? And would you come back to the Savior and say, I want to live in you fully and live in the second half of the gospel?